Very recently, September the 30th issue of Nature, Jan Witkowski and Alex Gann at Cold Spring Harbor Labs found the some of Francis Crick's papers from this
Well,
period.
They didn't find them. They were told to go and look in that box.
Ah, well,
let me just tell you.
Yeah, what is the story
happened.
Here? Because I suppose
the story is the correct story is the following. When Francis and I shared an office from the very first time we were together, when I came to Cambridge, that would be at the end of 1956, and we shared this office, and we were first down in the Austin wing, and then we moved to the hut where we shared an office until we moved up to the new labs there. And we had always pooled our reprints and so on, right? Now, the letters that I had must have been in some filing cabinet, right? Because Francis was always totally convinced and said so many times that they had been thrown out by a secretary and that he had no trace of these.
This is correspondence with Maurice Wilkins.
This is this whole batch of correspondence. Okay. Now, it contains with lots of other people as well. There are lots of letters from Alex Rich. It's all this early stuff that Francis had thought a secretary had thrown out. What had happened is they must have been put in a box, all right? And I had my stuff in boxes as well. And this must have been carried up to the lab when we had another office, and then lots of other things seemed to have been added in it. And so Francis then went through everything when he came back after he moved to the Salk and took all his stuff away. But he must have missed this box, which there were rooms where the stuff had just piled up like this, and I hadn't looked at it. And I knew that when they came to collect my archive, that there was this one box which had some interesting stuff in it. I didn't know what else was in it. And so I told them that there is this, and there's a mixture of later stuff, and there still is, I'm unearthing various things that are found in my files because, you know, they just had got mixed up. So I was quite surprised by what was in this box myself, and I think it was a thing. And what was so amusing about this is that I was telling them about, at the same time we were talking, about a book that I had enjoyed in South Africa, actually, with lots of overtone, called Quest for Corvo. Corvo was a rather...
Baron Rolf.
You've got it, Frederick Rolf. And this had connections with a number of other things, which had been somebody that I knew in Oxford, had been introduced to and spent a lot of time with, a man called Dawkins, not the present Dawkins, but a man who was professor, who was, at the time, was one of the sponsors of Rolf, actually. And so I had just said, well, isn't this, so I said, you know, this is exactly like the Quest for Corvo. It also begins with a bunch of papers, if you read the thing. And I said, this is not, it's not history, it's biography that you're doing an experiment with. So, but I think it would have been too much if we called it Quest for Crick.
So, do you have any sort of final analysis on how all that played out?
Well, I think, you know, what had happened is that I think that the kind of what becomes clear from that was that I'll tell you one other thing that was found out, which is interesting. What became clear from that is that was how unhappy Morris was with the situation, and did feel that the job had been taken away from him. And so I think that it wasn't just... So I think the picture of Jim as the sort of evil, sexist, you know, stealing her rightful products, which of course had been painted by many of the books, that was a bit exaggerated, I think, you know, in that view of things. But I think that it does throw quite a lot of light on, because that I knew that Francis had had a long period with Wilkins on this. Now, of course, if you read Wilkins's autobiography, there's just a slight hint of that. But I think he was very upset by it all. And it is one of the, I think, if you go back there, there's also some very interesting things, because there's also a letter in that box from the man who was the MI5 hunter of spies. It's stated in this as saying, could he come and see Francis? This was the man who caught Fuchs and so on. He's very well known. He was brought from Australia by Victor Rothschild to exonerate him from being, you know, the eighth man or whatever it was. And he was the one who found all these people. So, Spy Catcher, he wrote a book. Now, there's a letter from him to Francis saying, could he come and see Francis? And everybody wondered, what was Francis doing with Spy Catcher? And then, very shortly after discovering all of these books, the MI5 papers were released from the 1950s, you know. And in it there is a statement that Morris was suspected of being a Soviet spy.
Wilkins,
yes. But there's a most marvelous piece in this, which says that, and of course, because of an attitude he took while he worked on the bomb, you see. And the thing that he said there, one of his people testifying, said in the newspaper, it's in the Times, saying, oh, he's not so open with what the work he's doing these days for fear of getting scooped. But I don't think they did look in the files to see whether there was anything from France in the papers. But it may not have been released at the time, because they'll have to wait to another period to see, because this happened, I think, later.
Just thinking, you worked with, in this pretty much the same office with Francis Crick for 20 years?
Yeah, that would have been it. It was from 56 to, I think Francis left in 76.
Yeah. So how were your styles fit? Was this the Odd Couple or...?
No. It was... well, Francis had most of the use of the office, because in a sense I would come in and start to do experiments. But then, as you know, in England, everything's punctuated at almost hourly intervals by some meal or something. But by about coffee time, you know, we would start to get together to talk about things. And, you know, and then the afternoon was another good time to do experiments. And then, of course, tea time would come again. And sometimes we just got stuck in the office talking about things. But, and we also made certain that there was something called a coffee room, which, of course, everybody could come to, and which enabled people to talk together for all the time. So most people do remember their times in Cambridge as one where people just did a lot of talking and eating.
So this is the LMB, the Laboratory of Molecular Biology.
Yeah.
A lot of talking. There's actually a review here by Jan Witkowski of your own book, My Life in Science. Mm. And the title of it was The Man Who Talks a Lot.
Yes.
Which is apparently you.
Well, this is what Fred Sanger once said about me. He once said, Fred Sanger wrote something, and he said, Brenner's a... I forget, he said, he's a good scientist, he says, but he talks too much. Or talks a lot, I think.
This notion of getting together for these conversations seems to be part of the entire style
I think this is the thing in which everybody learns. You learn, you make fools of yourselves, you know, you then have to find out why you said certain things. And in general, I found that Francis, if anybody knows him, is an interrogator. If you say something, he will follow it through. And you have to be pretty certain of doing things. And he's not one to tolerate flabbing, you know, these things. But sometimes in the interaction, something emerges that neither you recognized to begin with. And that's what I think is the moment of, you know, productivity. That's how I think you can interact with people and produce something that's you know, much better than it was originally. Because, I mean, we used to spend hours talking on how many different kinds of nonsense are there in the gene, you see. I mean, is it all just one kind of nonsense, or are there some nonsenses which could be different things, you see, given the way of the synthesis. And then, you know, but of course all of that was not a correct phrasing of the thing, because once we realized from all the considerations about the code that there could be certain codons that didn't mean anything. That is, they would be nonsense. They would guarantee a phase, which is the thing of the Comolus code. But in fact, that's not the right way to frame it. So I think that it was working through all of these things that I think many of the good ideas, you know, came. And it was, I mean, the acridine mutants is a thing. It's absolutely the frameshift mutants which we used to prove that the code was triplets in nature, and red, you know, red without any nonsense in that sense. So we could, but that came about simply of having a discussion on a Saturday, I won't forget this, in the Eagle, the famous Eagle pub, and saying, well, why should one kind of chemical cause one kind of mutation at certain places, and another kind of chemical causes a completely different set of mutations. So they can't all be. So there was a puzzle about this. And we could solve it by just the suggestion which I made is that the dyes allow deletions and insertions. And once you say that, boom, you can immediately, because that was Saturday, and Sunday night we started some experiments to actually show that this made sense. And the experiments were done in a very short time. And they're the ones that pointed to this, and then, of course, followed the whole analysis of this. But I think that without having that discussion and making suggestions, I doubt whether that could have been generated per se. It was just a challenge. I was trying to explain why they were different positions that I think...
How do you think science has changed then since from those days?
Well, you see, there's one thing that has happened which I dislike intensely, and everybody knows this, that people now, because labs have become very big, I mean, you know, they have a whole hierarchy now of postdocs, senior postdocs, graduate students and so on. And the tasks are delineated within this, so they have group meetings. And I don't like those, because I think unless you can work one-to-one with a person, you can't learn anything from a group meeting. Because there's always the one who talks all the time, like me, you know, and there's always the one who keeps quiet and doesn't say anything. And in fact, I think it doesn't allow for the communication of the science. So I didn't like group meeting. These are very structured now, because labs are run like mini organizations. They've got to that stage. So I always thought the best thing you can do with a student is to find out why the experiment didn't work. I mean, to analyze experimental failures is the most important thing you can do in science. And I think there's now such a huge emphasis on proper mentoring, and I believe that most people aren't mentors for their students, they are tormentors of their students, and I don't think the student is going to benefit. And I mean, you hear of all sorts of things, of two students being put on the same problem, you know, in competition with each other. I mean, these things are just ridiculous. And I mean, now you have to say, I noticed, you have to say what each person contributed to the paper. You have to say, you know, this guy did this. But we never even discussed this, because it was very clear if you made no contribution, your name didn't go on the paper. It just didn't go on it. You had to have either done, I mean, we used to say you've either have to have done some of the work yourself, or you've had to make a suggestion or a recommendation that turned the whole work around, okay? And that didn't mean, you know, have you tried different temperatures and things like that. You have to have an incisive thing. Otherwise, your name didn't go on in Cambridge on the paper. It just wasn't the business of just adding everybody on. So I think the lifestyle has changed. And I think you should look, I think science to me was always like a medieval guild with, you know, your apprentices, apprentice to skilled journeyman and learning a craft from them. Mm-hmm. And I think that if you don't have that, if it's now going to become a kind of structured education, you're going to miss many of the things in science. And I should say that's one last thing I have done at my advanced stage. If I've started a lab in Singapore in which I only take the Singaporeans who are returning after study in America. And this lab has, they run it. I'm there just to guide them. I find this really great because it's like the old times, you see. They now will do the thing, they do the projects themselves. I don't tell them, now you will do this. Of course, I make suggestions. And we'll see what becomes of this, because they have to learn exactly that this is the gritty end of science, okay? And it is a subject which, if practiced, demands too many conflicting things. If you think about it, you have to be at once freewheeling, imaginative, original, creative. Yet comes the time you have to go in a straight line through brick walls, if necessary, to get to the point. And I have found many, many students who don't combine. They either know how to go through brick walls, or they know how to be imaginative but don't accomplish anything. So there's a good thing to genetically engineer.
So what would your advice be to a young scientist then?
I think he's got to be able to say what he's interested in. Okay, and I think science is so difficult and so hard work, basically, it's not easy, that you've got to really commit yourself to the solution of a problem. I mean, Francis had this right up to the last day. That is, there's a problem there, it hasn't been solved, okay, and we're going to try and solve that problem. Not that we're going to dig a little hole here, you know, and add another brick here. I mean, I think that you've got to have that sort of passionate engagement. And I don't think that people are, you know, from the way they ask, the way you people come to you and say what it is that you want to do, you know, and then they don't know. And the people that I have found, and I've often said this, the people who do the best are the outsiders. They haven't been brought up in the discipline, you know, they haven't had the academic background. So that's why it's strange that a lot of physicists made molecular biology. And that was because they didn't know too much. Okay, and I think the emigres are always the people who have the initiative. So I think this emigration in science, and we know people say that immigrants do well in America because they've had the go to get out of where they've been and do this, but I think it's true in the sciences as well. And I think you've got to have that possibility. And you've got to have this, and you've got to take the things to do is to discuss, which is, of course, Francis was really great at, to discuss problems and how you might solve them, and how you go, and rather than say, oh, well, this is this piece, and we must make an answer to this. So I think having that challenge is a good one.
That's also, you're suggesting having a big view, big picture of things as
well.
Yeah,
that's a big picture.
So, but why then do you also sometimes, I've heard you say very nasty things about this phrase, systems biology,
well,
which you call physiology with emphasizing.
That's just a fat thing. I mean, that's not big. That's got no muscle. It's just all adipose tissue, basically. No, because I think it hasn't formulated the question properly. Right, so let's just see what... You have to ask, what would true systems biology claim? Right, I've written a paper on this. I don't know, you can read it after this. Right, systems biology claims that by making measurements on the system, okay, by seeing the behavior of the system, we can work out what's going on inside, right? That's known as an inverse problem. Okay, you want to go to mechanism, you want to go to structure and function from behavior, okay? It's well known that you can't solve this for many reasons. And certainly in biology, certainly with the way people are doing this, that's an insoluble question. Okay. So the other possibility is to find out what's in the machine, right? And then show how it computes the behavior or generates the behavior. That's just classical, it's classical biology, right? So if you're going to say, well, you know, we can study this, then we can make perturbations and, you know, the usual stuff. But so far, I've not seen anything come out of this. And if you look at the classic cases of where this is a problem that have been studied, okay, you can exclude certain models. Okay, but you can't prove that what you've found is unique. All right. Because this is the essence. We want to find out what it is that's really doing this. Just take the following example. There's a chap playing the drums in a room. And we take microphones out there and we record the sounds. Right? And we are asked now, will you please tell us all the physical properties of the drum to generate these sounds. Now you can't do it because there's interference. You can't measure things accurately enough, right? So you would come out with it's a typical inverse question. But I guarantee you that if you knew the properties of the drum, okay, you could calculate the sounds made. You could generate the sounds from this. That, I think, is it. So it works in the forward direction, but the inverse direction isn't unique. There's no unique mapping. And the more complex the inner workings are, the less likely you are going to be able, from behavior, okay, to be able to see about mechanism. So I just think the best thing to do is let's just stick on mechanism. Let's try and find out if we know this, and then we should be able to compute it. Because the other thing says make more measurements. You know, we can go on making measurements till the cows come home, but basically we're not going to get much further simply because the translation of that little sequence of DNA through all the steps, through all its function in the cell, you know, through all the physiology of the organism is so remote, the output is so remote, that there'd be no way to map that very simply onto the genome. And that is why I think we are very confused. We talk about genes for alcoholism. You know, we might as well talk about genes for luck, basically.
That was the paper this was in the
Royal Society.
The Royal Society, yeah. Philosophical Transactions, 350th anniversary issue, yeah. Where I actually did read the paper, but which leads me to this point. There we're talking about a 350th anniversary of the foundation of the Royal Society.
Yeah.
So that's a long-running enterprise dealing with science. You have said somewhere that Peter Medawar wrote that science is the art of the soluble, and you take the position that science is the art of the inevitable. If you pursue it with passion and clever thinking, it's inevitable that you'll find out how everything in nature works. What do you think then, with those two caveats, with those two ideas, is the rightful place of science in society? I'm playing off the president's initial phrase there about restoring science to its rightful place.
Well, the first thing I'd like to say is that if it wasn't for science, we wouldn't have the societies. You know, because what I'm fond of saying is that it's taken us about 500 years to discover that magic doesn't work. Religion is unreliable, but science works, because I think everything we have here is due to the discoveries. And it seems to me that, as I always think, I think that as long as there are things that are puzzles, the problems which are not solved, there will be people who will seek for a solution to them. And I think that that is one of the great things about humanity. I mean, it could be that if we were a different sort of species, and there weren't these singular people out on the extreme ends of the distribution who think that this is a very important thing to do, I think the society wouldn't be as well off as it might be without us, because I think these puzzles will still exist. And certainly, I mean, to find out how this human brain works is, and that is what in the end Francis thought was the problem that he would try and solve.
Pick up that point, because you're a senior fellow in the Crick Jacobs Centre. That's Terry Sinofsky's lab operation, which is dealing with computational neurobiology. But this is something that you've been interested in for a long time. I think back when I read back that you were originally talking to Seymour Papert a long time ago.
Yes. Yes.
You're interested in John von Neumann's work and Turing's work. So computational ideas have always been a part of your background.
Very strong background, yes.
So
it's because I'm a lousy mathematician, and it's because I can understand what's going on when I can put it in computational terms.
So how do you see, how is your involvement with sort of brain sciences at this point, if any?
Well, at the moment, you see, I started, look, we decided that if you want to understand a nervous system of C. elegans, first it's finite. It's 300 neurons, all right? So let's find the wiring diagram. Right now, I make that very loose. And then instead of asking, and this is an idea I got long ago from von Neumann, basically, instead of asking all the behavior questions, for which it is true, we could do an experiment and find out, which is, you know, how would this worm behave if I put it on the lower surface of a satellite circling, you know, the star, right? If we understand the wiring diagram, we could compute that behavior, right? So we don't have to instantiate it with an experiment and answer a whole series of questions which are potentially endless. We can just abort it and say, we can just compute it for you. That is, we can do the experiment inside our heads or a calculating machine, same thing. We have a theory, and we can use the theory to predict the future. And that's what I call science. All right? Now, and I think if you've done that, that is you then understand a nervous system. You can then do what is called a proper simulation of it. And I think that the interpretation, and the more I go on, it's the interpretation of wiring diagrams in some broad sense, which of course not only involve physical connections, but they, you know, which direction things are going. So there's a lot more you may have to know than just the wiring diagram. So why shouldn't we aim for something that they do in electronic design? Okay, why shouldn't we be able to assemble mini nervous systems were the components, the cells, okay, and then run them and see how the organism survives. You see, how it changes. I mean, we've got mutant nematodes in which are wired up in a different way, and we can ask ourselves, is our knowledge sufficient to explain those mutations, all right? And I think we're getting pretty close to that with C. elegans. That's 300 neurons. So I think the definition of a wiring diagram, and then this could be even at the molecular level, what people call pathways, you should be able to calculate from this. Otherwise, you're not doing science. You've just become a journalist of the world, basically, just saying, you know, what's happening.
So, are you're connected with? Is this work goes on at the Salk, the Crick Jacobs Centre?
Well, what I think, you see, the thing that we've been, well, of course.
Are you also doing this in Singapore, though?
No, I'm doing it on my own nickel, as they say. Yes. No, I'm doing this myself, because what's a wonderful possibility now is there's this human genome sequence. It's free. Okay, all you need is a little computer like I have, you know, just a laptop. And I can go and do these things as I move around in this. The journals I can read, and they're not all free, by the way. I keep on getting demands for my credit card. But fortunately, I've got some other people to provide credit cards for that. But basically, I think never has there been, you know, such a wealth of information that's there, data, that's just crying out to be organized in some way. So I think that's the thing. But I always think what Francis did, and I think he always tried to get to one central problem, which if you can solve this, you would understand, you know, would be key to the next. And I think I've done the same, all right? Because I think the issue of what constitutes a cell type in the brain, okay, is the thing that we really have got to get to grips with. And I think that there's enough evidence lying around that one can have a model of what constitutes a cell type, right? And that was just a speculation some years ago, but I think now it's testable. It's testable not only by this, because what it does is it gives the key for how complex systems evolved. So I think even if one can accomplish that and get that concept through, then I believe I will have done something to really crystallize the notion of, you know, what these circuits are, how they built off things in this way. So I think the notion of a cell type, how it's defined in the genome, also can tell us how this evolved as well. So I'd like to know how the retina got to be the way it is.
So would you? So you think neuroscience is one of the most exciting research areas?
I tell you what I think is the research area that at least I would like to see. I think the research area, and I think the huge opportunities there. It's roughly speaking to close the gap between the brain and the genome. That is to find out how. Not only how circuits work, but how they are built, all right? And I think to see also, to try to get a grip on the evolution of complexity. So I think that gap, if you like, that's put in that way is, I think, the challenging area. And the thing is this, that people who work with genomes quite often know nothing about brains, and the people, your standard neuroscientist, is not very interested in genes. So I think there are huge opportunities there to seek for leverage in this. And I think this will be a very interesting thing. It will throw light on other things as well.
So as that goes forward, do you foresee any, do you have any qualms about the ethical issues that are, might be raised?
Well, I mean, I have always, you see, I am, on many of these things, there are very general, you know, there are these very general ethical things that people raise. But I've been accustomed, even though I was a terrible medical student, I have been accustomed to thinking in what is called practical medical ethics. You know, the many things that you face there, you know, certainly about information and so on, in which you have to say something. And I have pretty strong ideas on, strong views on certain things, which have to explore the relationship between, you see, we're talking about personalized medicine today. And don't believe that this means the doctor's going to treat you as a person. Far from it. He's going to treat you as a probabilistic element, you know, in a kind of thing like this. But classical medicine has always been what I call individual medicine, and not class you. Of course, today, most doctors just treat you as a bundle of organs, for each of which has a speciality attached to it, and nobody's interested, you know, in what's happening to the part of your body that isn't there. Because I think, as I once said, you see, that this business about talking about the brain and the ghost in the machine, you see, the Cartesian duality, that's not the right question, you see, because as far as I'm concerned, I want to know about the machine in me. In me, there's a machine in me that's doing this, and I want to know about it. And I don't believe there's any separation in that sense. So I think that is what's the important thing. Now, of course, I think one has to, you know, there's a lot of things that one has to think about in terms of the ethics of this. And you face various dilemmas in this case. But I think that as long as, you know, the exploration of, you know, so for example, there's the classic cases of, let me give you one example, right, which I think why I think focusing on individuals is important. I was once gave a lecture, you know, on this whole business of cloning people. So a chap got up in the audience, he was a professor in the local university, and he said, why can't I clone myself and keep the copies for spare parts? So I replied to him, I said, be careful, one of the copies might keep you for a spare part. You see, because it's a symmetrical thing. He did not see them as individuals. He did not see them as persons, okay? He just saw them just as a bundle of stuff, you know, that you could get a hand if something happened to yours, which is a very naive view, because you are much more than your genome. You know, your memories, you know, the way you identify yourself. And I think that as long as we maintain that in our dealings with the world, as long as we see that everybody is an individual and everybody needs to be this, then we do not have the confusions about, you know, is it right to clone people or not. So I think that that's the important thing when dealing with this particular species.
Do you ever have to issues that religious issues, for example? We've been talking a lot about, there's a lot of books out at the moment about morality, the origins of morality. There's a debate. We do the Beyond Belief meetings and so on.
Yeah, well,
you actually grew up in a Jewish household and were bar mitzvahed at some point.
Yeah, so
that's all gone.
To me, well, I mean, my son, when he was five, went to school, kinder, you know, preschool in Cambridge, and he came back and he said, they keep on telling us there's all this stuff about Jesus being, you know, out there in heaven, but I told them there's nothing out there except space. There's only space. So that's where I feel. There's nothing out there except space. So I don't have any, I mean, you know, there are lots of people want to talk, and I mean, yeah, people like Dawkins, who's now become a militant atheist and so on. But I like to tell a true story to finish up on this. So I was telephoned by the Gallup poll. This was during Clinton's presidency. And this young man, I assume it's a young man from his voice and so on, said, I'm going to do the Gallup poll, but you know, we're going to ask you some questions. Okay, said, fine. And then he said, I want to ask you some general questions first. And one of the questions, he said, what religion are you? So I said, I'm an atheist. There followed a long pause, and he said, I can't seem to find it on the list. So, you know, you have to start thinking, is atheism, is it a religion or not? So this is, so I said, put down no religion. But I mean, the conception, you know, that if you put an ism onto it, then it's got to be just another kind of strange brand of the same thing. So I think this is the thing that I think you have to, I think it's an individual decision. And you know, some people like ice cream and some people don't, basically. I hate spinach, for example. And I refuse to eat it. Anyway, but that's another thing. But I don't want to make you stop eating spinach if you like it.
Okay.
Is there anything else that you could ever thought about doing rather than being a scientist? Are you a sort of a frustrated opera singer or?
No, I don't think so. I think there's nothing else. Really, when I look back, there's nothing else that I've had more, well, you know, all the combination of hope, frustration, joy, this, then actually being able to use this technological platform, as it's now called, namely my brain, to try to probe something about this incredible scene we have here. So I don't think I want to do anything else.
You've met some remarkable people. I mean, who stands out and is as
well? There's lots of people that stand out, and in fact, I decided I'm writing a set of things about the people that I know. They'll be very short. So I already wrote one about Francis and one about Jim, but I think they will try and capture in a very short thing, you know, or the essence of the
people. Because usually you don't like writing. You usually don't want to do much
writing. Well, I don't do much writing, but I mean, I just, you know, when it gets in the mood, I will do it. But I've done one or two of these things, and I think, you know, of all the people that I've met through, you know, it's now a long life, because as I say, most of the people I know are dead or retired or both, basically. And so I think that this would be, but I think, of course, working with Francis and also working with François Jacob and Jacques Monod, as we had for about a decade or more in the past, those were all really great experiences.
Well, what about the projects you're working on at the moment? You're working on another on the brain stuff. You've still got the genome work that you're doing with the shark.
Yeah, sure.
So you must.
We still got a lot of things we need to do. Yes.
And you're on a plane. You came back from Japan about 3 days ago. You're off to Singapore in 2 days. You've traveled more than anybody I know.
That's because that is probably my only defect, is feeling responsible for the future. So we have to make sure things are done the right way.
So you're not no let up in travelling for Sydney Brenner then.
What do they say? It's not the arrival. It's the journey that counts. Actually, I tell you, it's neither. It's the departure that counts.
All right. Well, it's been great talking to you, Sydney.
All right. Amusing about this is that I was telling them about, at the same time we were talking, about a book that I had enjoyed in South Africa, actually, with lots of overtone, called Quest for Corvo. Corvo was a rather...
Baron Rolf.
You've got it, Frederick Rolf. And this had connections with a number of other things, which had been somebody that I knew in Oxford, had been introduced to and spent a lot of time with, a man called Dawkins, not the present Dawkins, but a man who was professor, who was at the time, was one of the sponsors of Rolf, actually. And so I had just said, well, isn't this? So I said, you know, this is exactly like the Quest for Corvo. It also begins with a bunch of papers, if you read the thing. And I said, this is not, it's not history, it's biography that you're doing an experiment with. So shared an office until we moved up to the new labs there. And we had always pooled our reprints and so on, right? Now, the letters that I had must have been in some filing cabinet, right? Because Francis was always totally convinced, and said so many times, that they had been thrown out by a secretary and that he had no trace of these.
This is correspondence with Maurice Wilkins.
This is this whole batch of correspondence. Okay. Now, it contains, with lots of other people as well, there are lots of letters from Alex Rich. It's all this early stuff that Francis had thought a secretary had thrown out. What had happened is they must have been put in a box, all right? And I had my stuff in boxes as well. And this must have been carried up to the lab when we had another office.
Very recently, September the 30th issue of Nature, Jan Witkowski and Alex Gann at Cold Spring Harbor labs found the some Francis Crick's papers from this
period.
Well,
they didn't find them. They were told to go and look in that box.
Ah, well,
let me just tell you.
Yeah, what is
had
the story here? Because I suppose
the story is the correct story is the following. When Francis and I shared an office from the very first time we were together, when I came to Cambridge, that would be at the end of 1956, and we shared this office, and we were first down in the Austin wing, and then we moved to the hut where we but I think it would have been too much if we called it Quest for Crick.
So do you have any sort of final analysis on how all that played out?
Well, I think, you know, what had happened is that I think that the kind of what becomes clear from that was that I'll tell you one other thing that was found out, which is interesting. What became clear from that is that was how unhappy Morris was with the situation and did feel that the job had been taken away from him. And so I think that it wasn't just... So I think the picture of Jim as the sort of evil, sexist, you know, stealing her rightful products, which of course had been painted by many of the books, that was a bit exaggerated, I think. And then lots of other things seemed to have been added in it. And so Francis then went through everything when he came back after he moved to the Salk and took all his stuff away. But he must have missed this box, which there were rooms where the stuff had just piled up like this, and I hadn't looked at it. And I knew that when they came to collect my archive, that there was this one box which had some interesting stuff in it. I didn't know what else was in it. And so I told them that there is this, and there's a mixture of later stuff, and there still is, I'm unearthing various things that are found in my files, because, you know, they just had got mixed up. So I was quite surprised by what was in this box myself. And I think it was a thing. And what was so